thanks so much for joining us here on the CBN News Channel. I'm Ephraim Graham.
And I'm Charlene Israel. President Obama is pursuing policy changes across government agencies in an effort to curb gun violence. Vice President Joe Biden will lead the administration-wide effort to formulate new policies and approaches to the problem. The administration gave no specifics. The mass shootings in Newtown, Connecticut have put guns and the mental health system under the national microscope. The debate, which one threatens our safety the most? Jennifer Wishon examines the brewing battle.
In the midst of the grief in Newtown, there are many questions. What if the shooter had no access to the guns? What if he'd received proper mental health treatment? And what if the principal or teachers had weapons to protect themselves and their students?
All mass shooting tragedies spark gun debates. Who should have them and what kinds? But this tragedy here in Newtown, coming on the heel of too many others, with victims so young, is sparking a debate neither the White House nor Congress expected.
These tragedies must end.
President Obama promises to use the power of his office to push for a ban on the sale of assault rifles. Legislation should be introduced in Congress next month.
It will ban the sale, the transfer, the importation, and the possession, not retroactively, but prospectively. And it will ban the same for big clips, drums, or strips of more than 10 bullets.
The president also wants to close the so-called gun show loophole. That allows the private sale of guns without background checks on buyers. New polling suggests the national mood on guns may be shifting. A CBS poll taken after the shootings reveals an 18-point increase in support for more strict gun laws compared to a poll from April. Gun control advocates are seizing the moment, protesting outside the NRA headquarters and applying heat on Capitol Hill.
Every year in America, 100,000 Americans are shot.
People like Colin Goddard.
I was shot four times on the morning of April 16, 2007 at Virginia Tech and survived. I'm here for the 32 that didn't.
The other wrinkle in both the Virginia Tech and Sandy Hook massacres, shooters with histories of mental health problems.
I think we absolutely should talk about the intersection of a lethal weapon and it relates to mental health.
5 years after Virginia Tech and 20 states still don't require a potential gun buyer's mental health history to go to the national background check system. According to doctors, 34% of Americans will have a significant mental health issue this year. Over the course of their lives, that number raises to 61%. And for many Americans, especially in rural areas, adequate care is a challenge.
Just the number of people that struggle with anxiety and depression alone are enough to say we need to do a better job in the mental health system. We need to be better at identifying people.
Dr. Mental says it's hard to predict which patients will act out on violent impulses. For its part, the NRA broke its silence Tuesday. Its statement reads, "Out of respect for the families and as a matter of common decency, we've given time for mourning, prayer, and a full investigation of the facts before commenting. The NRA is prepared to offer meaningful contributions to help make sure this never happens again." Several governors, including Virginia Governor Bob McDonnell, say it's time to have a discussion about arming school officials. It's a complex issue expected to get the full federal treatment in the new year. Jennifer Wishon, CBN News.
A review of the Benghazi attack on the U.S. consulate in Libya faults inadequate security and leadership failures. The report by the Accountability Review Board came out late Tuesday night. The review blamed grossly inadequate security and overdependence on Libyan militias for the tragedy in Benghazi, citing a failure of leadership in two bureaus of the State Department. It points out that the compound was lightly defended, showing a lack of oversight of security operations. Furthermore, officials did not improve security conditions after several troubling incidents prior to the attack. Finally, State Department officials in Washington denied requests for more security. The report did not single out individual officials, nor did it find fault with the U.S. military, stating there was not enough time for a response. The Accountability Review Board confirmed that, despite initial reports by the Obama administration, there was in fact no protest outside the compound before the attack, and that it was in fact carried out by terrorists.
It seems to have been hijacked, let us say, by some individual clusters of extremists.
The backlash from the White House's initial response led U.S. Ambassador Susan Rice to withdraw her name from consideration for the job of Secretary of State.
The review will be presented to the House and Senate Foreign Affairs panels this week.
A Florida man is accused of plotting a terror attack on a landmark in New York City. Rais Alam Kazi faced a judge at a detention hearing in South Florida Tuesday. Federal prosecutors say Kazi hatched a plot with his older brother, but they didn't have the money or bomb-making components to carry out the attack. Rais is a 20-year-old who was born in Pakistan. Prosecutors say he was motivated by the lectures of the radical cleric Anwar al-Awlaki, who was killed by a drone strike in Yemen, and he was trying to avenge his death.
Thousands of Egyptian protesters marched on the presidential palace in Tahrir Square Tuesday. They're protesting the Islamist-backed draft constitution. The demonstrations came after charges of widespread voting irregularities during the first round of voting on the document. The historic referendum is planned to be run in two stages. The second stage is scheduled for December 22nd.
Is Washington any closer to a deal to avoid January's fiscal cliff? Both sides are starting to make concessions, but there are still plenty of disputes. House Speaker John Boehner is proposing a measure known as Plan B. The bill would keep taxes from increasing on people making less than $1 million while negotiations with President Obama continue. Those negotiations focus on the tax hikes and spending cuts set to take place in the new year.
I believe it's important that we protect as many American taxpayers as we can.
The White House quickly shot down the plan, saying the deal doesn't ask enough of the wealthiest Americans and shifts the burden to the middle class and seniors. Boehner says he is still hopeful that an agreement can be reached.
A new study shows more children are now born outside of marriage. The report released by the National Marriage Project and the Institute for American Values. It focuses on what it calls middle America, the nearly 60% of Americans who complete high school but not college. Among that group, 44% of children are now born outside of marriage. That's up from 13% in the 1980s. Study co-author Brad Wilcox says, quote, marriage in middle America is at a tipping point, with unwed children threatening to become a new norm. Research shows children born or raised outside of marriage are more likely to suffer from a range of social and emotional problems.
Christian ministries, youth organizations, and government agencies recently met to strategize. Their goal, to help victims of human trafficking.
There's a huge need to establish shelters and services for them. This conference represents a big milestone in the anti-trafficking movement. Heather Sells reports.
Traffickers in the U.S. exploit more than 100,000 children every year. But even if the victims manage to escape, there's often nowhere for them to go. Across the country, there's only residential care available for less than 100 survivors.
The anti-trafficking movement is just beginning in many ways, and so there's still not a clear understanding of the best way to help victims and what is out there available to them. That's why advocates from around the country gathered in Washington recently to define what is available and the smartest way to help victims.
If you think about it, here is a 13, 14, 15-year-old girl, and she is being violated 8 to 10 times a night by a grown man. And can you imagine what that does to her emotionally, mentally, and physically?
Mary Frances Boley founded one of the country's first trafficking shelters in 2001. She and other advocates say comprehensive care is needed to begin to help victims overcome the deep trauma that they've endured. At a minimum, that means residential care, therapy, and education. Rachel Lloyd has run a shelter in New York for 15 years. She says informed staff is key.
You have to have staff who are trained and understand the issue. You need to have survivors on staff. You need to have folks who have had the same experience, because girls and young women are coming in already feeling so ashamed and stigmatized that to be in an environment where there's no one else who's been through their experience is really challenging.
The recent conference, sponsored by Shared Hope International, drew youth workers, ministries, and government agencies. Those attending say their gathering alone represents a shift, because for years, the tragedy of trafficking fell under the radar for most Americans.
Years ago, you wouldn't have filled up this room this way, and now, you know, we filled up this room and it's on webcast, and people around the world, around the country, are really paying attention.
But Lloyd and others also cautioned the work has just started.
In the last probably 2 years, we've seen like increase, and now we're beginning to see people wanting to develop services. But we still have a really long way to go from awareness to like actually bricks and mortar and programs and services.
George Sheldon runs a U.S. agency protecting children and families, and he admits the federal government is late to the cause. Anti-trafficking advocates say they don't expect much from the feds in this economy, but Sheldon says Health and Human Services is moving to develop a response and to help law enforcement.
Prosecute a trafficker, you have to have a willing victim who feels safe and secure.
Creating safety and security for victims is expensive, and detailed planning is needed to start up comprehensive care. But advocates say it's worth it because a desperate need exists and thousands of lives are at stake. Reporting in Washington, D.C., Heather Sells, CBN News.
Coming up, talking about evil. In the search for answers to stop more gun massacres, few people are discussing the spiritual causes. That's the topic of our next conversation up next.
I'm so glad we could be here for Larry.
I was surprised to hear there was no life insurance.
Funerals are so expensive. I hope Larry can afford it.
I know. That's why I'm glad I got a policy through the Colonial Penn program.
Do you think they have coverage for me? Something that'll fit into my budget?
Yes. You can get permanent coverage for less than 35 cents a day. You won't have to take a physical or answer any health questions. Plus, your cost will never go up and your coverage will never go down.
If you're between 50 and 85, you can get guaranteed Acceptance Life Insurance for less than 35 cents a day. There are no health questions or medical exam. You cannot be turned down because of your health. So call about the Colonial Penn program and ask one of their representatives about a plan that meets your needs.
I'm definitely going to call about the Colonial Penn program.
Call 1-800-219-1201 for free information and a free gift. Call now.
If you have diabetes and you're on Medicare, call now for a new pain-free meter. These new meters are more accurate, they're easier to use, and the best news is you don't have to prick your fingers anymore. Call now, and Arriva Medical will send you one of these new meters for free. And if you have Medicare, your testing supplies may also be covered. Arriva makes it simple. They bill Medicare directly. There are no upfront costs, and they deliver your supplies right to your door for free. With these new meters, there's no coding, you don't have to prick your fingers, and some of these meters even talk.
Your blood glucose reading is 122.
And if you call 1-800-284-9762, we will send you a free Betty Crocker Diabetes Cookbook filled with delicious recipes.
Call Arriva today. You'd be glad you did.
The murder of 20 children and 6 adults in Newtown, Connecticut has started a conversation about gun control and mental illness in our country. But there's one topic most politicians and media won't mention as a root cause behind such tragedies, the reality of evil and spiritual warfare. Dr. Russell Moore is dean of the School of Theology at Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. He recently wrote an article on his blog titled School Shootings and Spiritual Warfare. Dr. Moore, you maintain throughout history, evil has manifested against children. Can you give us some examples?
Well, we see in the biblical story, Pharaoh coming against the children of Israel. And then in the Christmas story that we think about this time of year, the birth of Jesus happens against a king who is trying to slaughter innocent children. And so the entire opening of the New Testament is filled with violence against those who are innocent, vulnerable kids.
Well, Christians know that the enemy of the world is Satan. Why would he specifically target children?
Well, I think we see in the scriptures, in the book of Revelation, the Apostle John sees a big picture of the entire history of the universe. And what you see there, he says, is a dragon, the old dragon of Eden, who is coming after the child of the woman. And I think the reason for that is because we know on the basis of the book of Genesis that the very first threat that God made to Satan is that it would be a child of the woman who would crush his head. Mm-hmm. And so every time the satanic powers see children, what they see is newness of life, and they see those who share the nature with our Lord Jesus, a nature that they abhor. That's one of the reasons why you have Jesus warning about those who would cause little ones to stumble, those who would harm children. And on the other hand, why Jesus commends children, receives children, and says, unless you become as little children, you cannot enter the kingdom of God.
Why do you think we're seeing it so much more today?
I'm not sure that we are seeing it more today than we've seen in previous generations. Probably some of us are seeing it more than we've seen in our lifetimes. But when you look at the history of the world, being a child is a very, very dangerous place to be. Mm-hmm. Children were vulnerable in the Roman Empire. Children were vulnerable in all sorts of societies throughout history. And children are vulnerable right now all around the world. The danger that comes with being a child is ever present. It's just that usually we don't see it with the kind of shock and horror that we've seen this past week.
Well, you write about spiritual warfare and evil, and we're talking about it now. But why won't media or politicians or most churches, for that matter, acknowledge the existence of evil?
When something like this happens, you do see people start to talk about evil. Now, they generally don't talk about evil in personal terms the way that we would as Christians, but they do see that something really awful has happened here. And there's a sense of needing to express the gravity of this. And I think that's a good impulse. When it comes to our churches, I think that American churches have been so modernized in ways that we haven't noticed. That we're reluctant to talk about demons and devils because somehow it makes us sound unsophisticated and a throwback to a previous generation. But our brothers and sisters in the third world, I think, are more in touch with the biblical worldview and are able to speak in terms of demons and principalities and powers in the heavenly places.
That said, how are Christians called to fight evil or Satan, for that matter?
Well, I think the primary way is through the proclamation of the gospel. I mean, the power that Satan has is not only that kind of violence that we have seen over and over again and that we've seen so clearly this week, but the power that he has is primarily that of accusation, where there's no hope, where the final word is a word that comes through a murderer's gun or comes through Roman spikes in crucifixion. The gospel says there's another word behind that, that life is better than death. There is evil out there, but we believe that the light has overcome the darkness. You know, the other day I was walking through a bookstore and I heard someone standing there talking about how much he hates Christmas music. And he said, I hate Christmas music because it's so boring. Everything in Christmas is just so sentimental and gauzy. And I wanted to stop and turn around and say, no. That's not what the Christmas story is about. It's a dark and bloody story in which there is real darkness and real evil, but there is one who has overcome.
That's right. He offers us a hope in the future. Dr. Russell, thank you so much.
Thank you. Good to be with you.
Up next, it's a one in a million milestone. We'll go on a special Operation Christmas Child delivery.
Dear Bowflex, I dropped 8 dress sizes, 36 pounds, and all I had to do was walk.
This is the Bowflex Trek Climber Machine, the easiest way to walk and burn up to 3.5 times the calories. By combining the motion of a treadmill, a stepper, and an elliptical, you get the calorie burning benefits of all 3 workouts at once.
I lost 30 pounds in 4 months. If I can do it, anyone can do it.
Call now for your free DVD and information kit. You'll see how the Trek Climber burns up to 3.5 times the calories of a treadmill. Right now, you can own a Trek Climber machine today and get special financing for 18 months.
Within the first couple of weeks, I started to lose inches. I lost 50 pounds in 3 months using the Trek Climber.
I lost 150 pounds in such a short period of time. All my friends are like, how did you do it?
To look better and feel younger, call or go online to buytc.com for your free DVD and information kit today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bowflex.
Sincerely, J.D. Weber.
Friends, Pat Boone here with an important message from Swiss America. The world's money system is very unstable now, sending the price of food, gasoline, education, health care, almost everything higher and higher. You know, I can remember when a cup of coffee was just 5 cents. You remember that, don't you? Today, it costs $5 for the same cup of coffee. I also remember when $20 could buy this ounce of gold. Today, it costs nearly 100 times more for the same ounce of gold. Some say gold is an ancient relic, too old-fashioned to be money anymore. Well, guess what? Now it's paper money that's seen better days. So don't put your family or your future in jeopardy. Convert your paper into gold. Call the professionals, my trusted friends at Swiss America, while you still have time. Protect your standard of living from a rising cost of living with a gold standard.
For 20 years, gift-filled shoeboxes have brought joy and hope to millions of children around the world at Christmas time.
Now, one shoebox from Wisconsin traveled to the Dominican Republic to mark a milestone. George Thomas has the story of the shoebox.
Hi, my name is Evelyn, and I'm 12 years old.
This is the story of a young girl from a small town in Wisconsin with a big dream.
I've wanted to help the poor for a really long time. I was praying for it since I was 6 years old that I would be able to help the poor.
Evelyn Pino's prayer was answered when she heard about Operation Christmas Child, an outreach headed by Franklin Graham, elder son of evangelist Billy Graham. The idea, fill shoeboxes with gifts and deliver them to needy children around the world.
You wouldn't think that a simple gift like this could have that kind of impact. But for kids that are in orphanages, kids that are in poverty, kids that are living in dumps, kids that are in areas of conflict, war, to give them a gift, to let them know that there's somebody that knows who they are and cares about them and loves them.
Evelyn was that somebody. She started the Shoebox Club at age 8. It began small, but grew quickly. Around 80 kids meet each month now to pack shoeboxes.
We've been running for 4 years. In those 4 years, we have packed 2,500 shoeboxes. I want to help kids because I want them to be able to feel loved and know about Jesus, like I do. Kids helping kids around the world, that's my motto.
You see, her shoeboxes represent millions of lives touched by a simple act of kindness. 10 million shoeboxes will be hand-delivered this year by land, air, sea, trucks, boats, trains, and even elephants. In December, the project reached a milestone, delivering shoeboxes to more than 100 million children since starting in 1993.
What a great reason to celebrate today!
Inspired by her passion for helping the poor, 12-year-old Evelyn Pinner was picked by Operation Christmas Child to hand-deliver the symbolic 100 millionth shoebox to a young child in the Dominican Republic.
Here, guys, do you need help over here?
She turned to her friends at the Shoebox Club for help in putting the 100 millionth box together. They decorated it with a white paper covered with handprints from all the children serving in the group.
Thanks, everyone. I couldn't have done it without you guys.
Then for several weeks.
I love you. I'm proud of you.
Love you, Daddy.
You're so awesome, sweetie.
Thanks, Dad.
She crisscrossed the country, taking this special shoebox on tour.
This is actually Operation Christmas Child's 100 million shoebox, and we're going to need all of your guys' help to pack shoeboxes.
At each stop, people put different mementos in the box. Then on a recent Wednesday morning,
the last time we were sitting in a car traveling through a city, we were in New York, dreaming about this moment, and now we're finally here. Are you so overwhelmed?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Practicing my Spanish.
Thousands of miles from her home in Fort Atkinson, Wisconsin.
Wow, finally here.
Evelyn's prayer of helping needy children was answered. Tres, dos,
uno. Well, it's a simple box with simple toys. In this particular box is a stuffed animal, some tissues, hygiene material, a book, but you know, for Samaritan's Purse and Operation Christmas Child, a simple box with a powerful message. Each box delivered to these kids in the name of Jesus Christ.
At each distribution, the gospel is shared, and children are given the opportunity to learn more about Christ through a 12-week discipleship program.
God can do anything, and if you believe that God can do anything with you, then anything can happen. I am fine. I'm finally get to be able to go and deliver this box to a little girl.
In a small village in the Dominican Republic, Evelyn met 5-year-old Brenda Valdez.
What's this?
And handed her the special shoebox filled with toys, school supplies, and a pink children's Bible.
It's It's in the bottom.
The two girls spent time going through the presents. One special item was a heart-shaped necklace with the words, "Best Friends Forever." Brenda broke it in two, giving one half of the necklace to Evelyn as a reminder of their special bond.
If you see my pray, amen.
George Thomas, CBN News, in the Dominican Republic.
Hi, Anthony Sullivan here for the Sticky Buddy, the sticky roller that has the power of glue without the goo. Use it on all types of fabrics, even silk and suede, and doesn't leave a sticky residue. Sticky Buddy's little rubber fingers reach deep into your carpet and get things your vacuum cleaner hasn't seen in years. Then when it's full and dirty, just rinse it, dry it, and it's sticky all over again. Cats and dogs will love you even more if you use it as a pet brush. The Sticky Buddy normally sells for $20. It comes with a cover, so it stays nice and clean and has a lifetime guarantee. You'll also get the detail size. Take it with you. It'll be there when you need it. It even has a corner detailer with the same rubber fingers that gets into nooks and crannies. Be one of the first to call, and you'll get both for $10. But order right now, and you can double the value. That's two sets of Sticky Buddies for $10.
Call 1-800-601-7204 and pick up your Sticky Buddy. But hurry, call now. We're giving away a special offer and a second set of Sticky Buddies with all orders today. That's 1-800-601-7204. Call now.
How can you get a crispy restaurant tortilla bowl, but without frying it in oil, grease, and fat?
Just do what I do. Hi, Mark Gill here with the perfect tortilla pan. The fast, easy way to shape, bake, and create delicious tortilla bowls. Place any tortilla into the nonstick pan, pop it in the oven, and in just 5 minutes, perfect tortilla bowls that are always golden and crispy. Fill them with steak and peppers for a crunchy fajita bowl. Perfect Tortilla Pan's exclusive design works with all tortilla sizes, forming a deep-shaped edible bowl. Plus, it's all dishwasher safe. We'll send you not one, but two for just $10. Call right this minute and we'll double your order free. Just pay separate processing and handling. Every caller today will receive our cutting cup to slice, dice, chop, mince, and measure as it cuts. Yep, you get it all for just $10.
To order Perfect Tortilla for $10 plus processing and handling, call 1-800-301-7829 or order online at buyperfecttortilla.com.
Finally, every now and then, we all could use a really good hug.
Indeed. A California group is going around and doing just that. Volunteers from Hunting Happiness Project set up a Love and Aid booth at the Oakland Farmers Market. They offered hugs, high fives, or even just a word of encouragement.
Love can really cover up and then kind of help you get through the day. Love, I think that's something that's stronger than anything.
It was really nice for somebody to reach out and just be nice. Something we need to do more of, I think.
Amen. Volunteers also wrote notes of encouragement, and help was made available for people struggling with hunger, homelessness, and unemployment.
The gentleman said that, you know, a hug and love is just more powerful than anything.
That's what the world
God
needs.
God is love.
He is indeed.
Excellent. That's all for now. On the CBN News Channel, you can find more of our exclusive coverage of the issues you care most about at cbnnews.com.
See you next time. Have a wonderful Wednesday.
If you have diabetes and you're on Medicare, call now for a new pain-free meter. These new meters are more accurate, they're easier to use, and the best news is you don't have to prick your fingers anymore. Call now, and Arriva Medical will send you one of these new meters for free. And if you have Medicare, your testing supplies may also be covered. Arriva makes it simple. They bill Medicare directly. There are no upfront costs. And they deliver your supplies right to your door for free. With these new meters, there's no coding, you don't have to prick your fingers, and some of these meters even talk.
Your blood glucose reading is 122.
And if you call 1-800-284-9762, we will send you a free Betty Crocker Diabetes Cookbook filled with delicious recipes.
Call Arriva today. You'd be glad you did.
Introducing the CBN Bible from CBN.com. Now, an easier way to study the Bible and grow in your faith. Highlight your favorite verse. Read separate versions at a glance. Click and read a commentary, or cross-reference your favorite verse using the Strong's Concordance. All the right tools to study the Bible, all in one place. The CBN Bible, available at cbn.com/Bible or the iTunes App Store.